morning.
Good morning.
Anybody have any announcements or joys and concerns?
I have a joy in that my daughter made it back from the Burning Man when she was in the desert with 70,000 people. She got back.
She got back. Good. We're glad she's big journey. Good. Any other?
Amanda, happy birthday.
Anybody else have a birthday? I know Sloan's going to have a birthday on Tuesday. Is that true? All right, let's sing happy birthday to the girls. Happy birthday to you. Doubt you will have wonderful birthdays. Any other announcements from you?
I'd like to make a prayer request.
Yes, ma'am. And Robin was the wife of Jorn Keller, who was the son of Bob and Dixie Keller. And Robin is, had surgery and needs our prayers. Yes, ma'am. Yes, Louise Schlipp fell and broke her leg, and I think she's in Swedish at this moment. But I understand she may be going to rehab up in Denver for a while, which makes sense. And anybody have a report on Bailey? This morning, Lisa Holdsworth said that she was responding, which is good. And let's see, anybody else that was mentioned at 8:30, Tom? Anyway, we'll keep those people in our prayers. From the bulletin, through the month of September, remember we're collecting food for the food pantry, and there is a container out there that Jim LaFond promises not to dip into for he and Shirley. And anyway, so bring your goods. I also think there is a container at the grocery store.
There will be.
Oh, okay. Nothing in there you like, right, Jim? So, also, there's going to be a six-week Bible study starting October the 2nd through November the 6th. And the ones that Tom and I have participated in the past are very fun and interesting. It'll be on Monday night at 7 o'clock. The most fun was having a group together. We kind of bonded, found out how everybody felt about this particular scripture, and we didn't all agree, and that was just fun and fine and led for great discussion. So I hope you'll consider that as couples, as individuals, as old, new, whatever. They just proved to be some great time together. And there's a sign-up sheet back yonder to sign up for reading scriptures for church. And if I can do what I'm doing today, you can read scriptures. So don't be shy. Nobody bites, and they haven't thrown darts yet. They might after a minute or two here today. But please consider reading scriptures maybe two or three Sundays between now and Christmas, the new year. And next Sunday is the Parsonage Open House. Sponsored by the PPR committee. We haven't been inside the parsonage for quite some time, so I think it'll be fun to go and have fellowship there. So keep that in mind. Yes, Robin.
Just a couple save the dates. On Monday, the 2nd of October, is changeover at the thrift store.
So October 2, changeover thrift store. Need lots of hands. Come in and eat Robin's cake. She usually has two sheet cakes, and they last at least a week. So,
yes. Another save the date to be putting on your calendar is the 20th of October, which is a Friday night, and that will be the evening soup supper here. It's the last football game, and it's senior night. So keep that on your calendar.
October 20th, soup supper right here prior to the last football game.
And sign-up sheets will be up in the next week or 10 days.
Any help you can provide, either your assistance or bring us a pie or whatever, but the sign-up sheets will be up soon. Anything else? Okay, as we prepare for worship, we'll listen to the prelude by, what's her name? Althea. See, it's contagious.
The opening prayer is in your bulletin, and we will give it in unison. Spirit of the wind and fire, come to us this day, freeing us from our fears. Lift us up when we have fallen. Remind us that we are never far from your presence. Get us ready for the great adventure and opportunities that lie before us. Help us to be good and willing workers for you. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Our gathering hymn is in the small, The Faith We Sing. It is Spirit, Spirit of Gentleness, and it's 2120, and would you all rise, please?
Thank you.
responsibly the call to worship as you find it in your bulletin. Sometimes our hearts are shut up like the doors that imprisoned the disciples.
Come, Holy Spirit, with your mighty wind of justice, release us.
Darkness floods our souls, and we wonder if we will ever see the light again.
Come, Holy Spirit, let the flames of fire touch our hearts and burn away our fears and frustrations.
When will we ever feel the power of your love again, O God?
Come, Holy Spirit, fill our lives with your love and free us to reach out to others with the good news of your eternal presence. Amen.
You can be seated. Okay, I invite all of our young members to come forward for
Ahoy, mate. Do you know what that means? Okay, we're hooked on Jesus and we're going fishing this morning on the big sea, okay? So when a sailor says to another sailor, ahoy, mates, what do you say back? Ahoy, okay? Do you think we can do that? I'm seeing a lot of doubtful faces. People out there can help, okay? All right, get ready? Ahoy, mates. Good job. You did do it. Well, we are going fishing today. We're going to learn about how we can be hooked on Jesus. So we have fishing poles that we're going to do. I also have a lovely Elsa, thank you, Ainsley, tackle box. So we are definitely ready to go. Plus, Erica has a minnow bucket, authentic too. So we are ready to do fishing, guys. So, and we're going to learn about Jesus walks on water. Jesus is the captain of our boat. Jesus' hands help others, like the fishermen, and so can mine. And Jesus said after the disciples found out there were 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, he said, you can be fishermen of men. Follow me. So let down your nets and do not be afraid. So we have lots of things to learn about as far as being hooked on Jesus, and that will be our, that'll be our theme for the whole year. So hooked on Jesus. So everybody can join in for sure. Okay? So that will be later, guys. Okay. And we have a very special person we want to recognize, and that is Pat. And Pat, would you come forward, please? And she taught Sunday school all summer long. And we feel like she is just a wonderful, dedicated teacher. And we want to honor her and say thank you very much. I did ask some of the kids what you liked about summer school and what you liked about Miss Pat. Are you ready? one of the students said, thank you for caring enough, this is about Miss Pat, to spend time teaching Sunday school. And others said, this was a girl. She said, I like that they learn about God and they learn about what he can do. And Miss Pat is always so patient and positive. Aww. So, we have a gift. But first of all, I think everybody should know a little bit about what happens in summer Sunday school. Because lots of times we are not here in the summer. We're going places and doing things. And anyway, so Pat, would you share a little bit about summer Sunday school?
Well, when I started summer Sunday school, I knew that it would be off and on because, like Debbie said, everybody's busy, and I always knew that there would be some Sundays that I didn't have any kids, and that has not happened since I started. I have always had some kids. Over the last few summers, we have talked about some parables. We have talked about, even though we're little, we can do big things. We learned about the Ten Commandments, and I tried to get it so that if you miss one Sunday, you don't miss out, and we just kind of go over it. This year I started out with the Sunday. I had several kids that day, and I told them I wanted them to think about three positive things about themselves. And it took them a while. And I said, you guys, I could probably name 10 for each one of you. And so we came up with, they were kind. They were good at football. Some of them looked like their dad. One of the kids said, can I put that I'm a good driver? And I said, yes, if you think you are. And her sister looked at her and she said, Madison, you are not a good driver. But I wanted them to know that we are all different and that no matter what, we are all special in God's eyes. And then each Sunday after that, we talked about how God helps us handle our emotions. We talked about anger. We talked about fear. We talked about love. And how all of those things are part of each one of us. And even when we become angry, God still loves us. The Sunday of love, they all colored magnets. And the challenge was to give it to someone after church that they did not know. That it's the little things that we do that make us who we are. And that's why, like I said, we are all different, but we are all special. And no matter what we are going through, that Jesus is always with us. And I was gone for 2 weeks to Europe, so, you know. I know.
She did. Well, anyway, we love Miss Pat, and we are so glad she shares her gifts and talents, and she says, here I am, Lord. And she comes here for the summer session. So I think we should do a round of hearty applause, okay?
Good morning. How is everyone this morning? Good. I got lots of goodies here with us today. So, today we're going to talk about sin. Can anyone tell me what sin is? What does that word mean? Lies. Yeah, what else does that mean? What else could that mean? Doing something bad, yes. Okay, anyone else? I know you're not this quiet normally. Okay, the Bible tells us about how Jesus died on the cross to forgive all of our sins. But what does that really mean? What's that really look like in our lives? So we're gonna do a little demonstration to kind of to show that, okay? All right, so let me make sure I have all my goodies in order here. So here is a penny, okay? That penny represents each of you, okay? It represents all of us. So we're going to put that on the plate. The plate's going to be our life, okay? All right. Now, I've got some red-colored water here, okay? And this represents our sin, okay? So we're going to pour this on the plate over the penny. And this represents how we are covered in sin. Okay, move this guy out of the way here. Now we have a candle. And the candle represents Christ. And since Jesus is our light, we're going to put him at the center. Actually, I'm going to light him first. So we are going to put Jesus at the center of our lives. Okay, so we've got the penny that represents us. We've got our sin, but then we have Jesus right in the middle of our lives, okay? So now we're going to put this jar over the top of Jesus. And we're going to watch what happens. Whoa, what happened? The bubbles, yeah. Look at how all of that sin just went away from us. Pretty cool, huh? So that's what Jesus did. God sent Jesus, and he died on the cross to take away each and every one of your sins. And he keeps taking those sins away every single day. Every single day he forgives you. Now, that doesn't mean we should intentionally do things that Jesus would not agree with. But Jesus died for each of our sins so that we can one day be with him again. Okay? All right, we're going to pray now.
Pray with me.
Dear Jesus, we pray that you'll help us to see our sins and stop doing them. We want you to live in our hearts, and we want you to do the right things, and we want to do the right things for you. Amen.
Amen. And we have treats for you. You guys get to go to Sunday school. It's kickoff Sunday. All right?
Woohoo!
Scriptures for today, the Old Testament is in Psalms 51, verses 11 and 12. Do not cast me from your presence, or take your Holy Spirit from me. Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and grant me a willing spirit to sustain me. The New Testament lesson is from Ephesians, and I don't think we'll do it responsibly. I'll just read it, read the verse. It's from Ephesians 1, 11 through 14, but I think you can see it on the screen. In him we were also chosen, having been predestined according to the plan of him who works out everything in conformity with the purpose of his will, in order that we, who were the first to be put our hope in Christ, might be for the praise of his glory. And you also were included in Christ when you heard the message of truth, the gospel of your salvation. When you believed, you were marked in him with a seal, the promised Holy Spirit, who is a deposit guaranteeing our inheritance until the redemption of those who who are God's possession, to the praise and his glory. That is the gospel lesson for today. We will now sing Just a Closer Walk to Thee, and it's also in the smaller hymnal, 2158.
I'd like to share with you what my Christian faith means to me and how it impacts and influences my life and how I think I got where I am at this point in my life. You'll notice our first hymn was Spirit of God, the Holy Spirit, and there were words in this particular hymn that spoke the same thing, and I really think many of our hymns, if we would concentrate on their words, have a message all their own. Ours, in many denominations, speak of the Trinity, a triune God, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. My understanding is that the three are equal. In the Old Testament, God tried to get the message across by using ordinary and less than perfect individuals. Moses had a speech impediment and didn't want to lead the people, but God said, "Do it anyway." Take Aaron. He can talk for you. My guess is God had faith in Moses' wisdom and his leadership abilities. God asked Jonah to go to Nineveh, and Jonah ran the other way. After 3 days in that whale, I guess he decided God meant business. After much frustration with his people, Jesus sent his son Jesus to demonstrate to us how we're supposed to treat others, how we're supposed to practice humility. And Jesus taught through his parables and demonstrated in person God's intentions for us. Before Jesus headed to Jerusalem for his imminent death, he told his disciples in John 14:16, "I will ask the Father, and he will send another companion, counselor, advocate, who will be with you forever, the Holy Spirit." Thus, the triune God and the Trinity, there's a lot of emphasis on Jesus. A few weeks ago, Pastor Rios asked, "What do you say? Who do you say Jesus is? What kind of relationship do you have with Jesus? Does it extend beyond a pew in the church and beyond this building?" Questions we need to contemplate many times every day. And then there were those bracelets, which are probably still around, with WWJD. What would Jesus do? However, for me, the Holy Spirit deserves more emphasis. Allow me to explain why and how. Several weeks ago, I did a children's sermon on the I'm Third motto, which came into my life from the YMCA camp that I attended for 8 years down in the Ozarks. The I'm Third motto was God first, the other fellow second, and I'm third. And that stuck with me, obviously, into my 70s. I have two older brothers, and prior to their attending Boy Scout camp every summer, they attended this camp, and when I visited with my parents on Visitor Sunday, I saw this camp, and I said, I want to go there. I want to come here. Well, I did for 2 weeks and 3 weeks for many years, from 9 until I was in high school. Now, let me tell you about this camp. And maybe you'll help understand who I am or who I shouldn't be or what I could have, anything. Anyway, this camp was pretty rustic. There were about 10 or 12 cabins, as I recall, and each cabin had 8 campers and 2 counselors. They were basically screened-in porches. We did have some canvas flaps that we could put down in case it rained. Of course, we were already wet by the time we went outside and got the flaps down, but that was part of the fun of it. We had no running water and no flush toilets. So at the end of one at the cabin row was John 1. At the other end was John 2, and they were three-holers. So every morning, evening, whenever you had friends that would participate with you. We had a gang shower up on the hill. Now, I don't know how they got the water up on the hill, but the gang shower, you had to walk up the hill with your flashlight, take all your stuff with you, and it had no roof on it, just had a kind of a wall fence around it. It was a concrete slab with about 5 different shower heads, and that's where we showered, and then we'd walk back down the hill in the dark with our flashlights to our cabin. We swam in a lake. Some people would call it a glorified pond. We had swim lessons there every day. I got my junior life-saving badge there. There was canoeing and rowboating and horseback riding and riflery and arts and crafts. And it was heaven on earth, just heaven on earth. Following breakfast, we were sent back to our cabins to clean it and do other chores, some of which were cleaning John 1 and John 2. And after that, we met at the pavilion for announcements, directives for the day, and devotions. At night in our cabins, after the evening activities and we were all settled in, devotions. Sundays was quite impressive to me. I still think about it. Everyone was asked to bring white shorts and white t-shirts for Sunday. So the entire staff and all the campers went single file through the woods, over the river, basically a stream, and there was a bridge, up the hill to the chapel. And we were all in white. Once we crossed that bridge, it was silence. We had our chapel. We sang songs. The chapel looked out over the lake. There was a big cross in the front of the chapel, which as we sat, we looked at, and it was, against the lake. Chapel was over. We went back through the woods, over the bridge, and then we could talk again. To me, that was an exercise in reverence, and it was important to be reverent as you approached church, chapel, whatever. The last night of camp was the same every year. It was pretty sad because after 2 or 3 weeks, you'd made some really good friends. You were going to leave them. But the last night of camp, the very last thing on the agenda was the cross that was across the lake from where we were sitting. It had been, it was probably 10, 12 foot tall, maybe, I don't know, but it had been wrapped in rags and soaked in some kind of kerosene, probably wasn't gasoline, and it was lit. And we sang, "On a hill far away stood the old rugged cross," all the verses while that cross burned. One year, some of the staff members sang it in four-part harmony. So for all the years that I was there, that was the closing campfire. And that picture is still very much in my head. And when I hear that song and sing that song, you can guess what I'm thinking about. The scene I relive every time I sing that song is priceless to me. Later, when I was assigned as a counselor in training, probably I was 15, to the outpost camp that was up behind where the cross was, we dug our own latrines. We sang, slept in one of those big, beautiful army tents, that housed, 10 or 12 cots, and we trenched it. After the first rain, we found out how well we hadn't trenched it. But anyway, we set up a little kitchen, and we were going to live up there. And one day, the senior counselor asked me to go out and see if I could find a place for a chapel, just for our little outpost camp, and I did. And there, after not much walking, was a tree. A tree with three equal trunks that were in a triangle. And I'm sorry, the first thing I thought about, even at 15, was the Trinity. And I thought, who led me to this tree? Out of all the trees in the Ozark Mountains, why this one I happened upon? But there it was, so I promptly thought, this is the site. I lashed together a cross and was able to wedge it in between the trunks and tie it securely, and then I managed to put a candle somehow right behind the cross pieces of the cross so that there would be a glow. And I cleared a path and maybe drug in some logs for people to sit on. And there was only like 10 or 12 of us up there at that outpost camp. But there was the chapel. Who led me to that tree? I believe the Spirit of God. Jump ahead to 1984. Grant Keller had no food in his mouth except me. And one day, he stopped nursing. And he never nursed again. He didn't like Cheerios, crackers, or anything. As it turned out, we were at Children's Hospital for 3 weeks in June. He went off feed in April, so we had some tough months. But anyway, you know, the whole time that he was sick and we were at the hospital, I had this feeling within me that they will figure out what's wrong with him, and it's not life-threatening. I don't know where that comfort came from, but it was there. And while we were at the hospital, I read those kind of like the Upper Room devotional book every day. I don't know who wrote those devotions, but they must have known that I was going to need them in Children's Hospital in 1984. Because every day, those devotions spoke to me. How? I believe there was a spirit involved. I spoke to other parents trying to encourage and empathize with them. And I later wondered where the words came that I shared with them. The words that came out of my mouth were not ones that Lee put together. But I know where they came from. Also, while I was up there, I was having lunch in the cafeteria, and I had this, and I mean, overpowering urge, put your tray down, get up, and walk across the street to Spalding Rehab, where Barb Zimbelman and Reuben were. I didn't know Barb and Reuben, although Barb had come to visit me, and Reuben was in the rehab. But this urge said, go, and go now. So I did. And I got over to the door of the rehab center, and here was Barb walking out with her hand on the door, and I was walking in, and we met face to face. Now, what are the chances? What was it that said, go and go now? She needed to talk. That happened to be her and Reuben's wedding anniversary day, and she needed to visit. So I did, and glad that I did. In 2010, Tom was suffering from many, many effects of Lyme disease, chronic Lyme. And I was home, and I heard this voice again that said, turn on the Christian radio station, which I don't listen to on a regular basis. And the message that day that was going on was about pruning. And you know that I know some things about pruning with gardening and whatever. But the whole message was about pruning the vineyards to make the fruit more plentiful, to make the plant grow better. Well, as they went on with talking, Tom and I were being pruned. I don't think we got pruned with clippers. I think we might have had loppers. Who told me to turn on that radio station at that moment to hear that particular message that I needed to hear? I try to keep my life focused on God, realizing all the blessings that he has bestowed on me. I think we all work at living life the Jesus way. For me, I try to be tuned in to that voice of the Holy Spirit, urging and encouraging me to say, to do, to act, to think like Jesus and his earthly example. And by doing that, we're pleasing God. May we all listen intently to hear that voice that encourages and comforts, prods us into action, and realizing that our actions and words will be pleasing to God and representative of Christ. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as you make yourself known to us through your Spirit, may we be very receptive of it, and may we be appreciative of the counselor that you have sent to us to be with us throughout our life. Without it, without that Spirit, perhaps we might fall and stumble, which we'll do anyway, but with it, we have a better chance. We thank you for your grace and your love. May we do our best to exemplify your Son Christ in all that we do, in how we treat people, what we say, and encourage us to reach out, even in this congregation. Be willing to go to Bible study. Be willing to read some scriptures. Be willing to go over and above in any way that we can with whoever we meet. In Jesus' name we pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We'll now worship with our offering. Father, may these gifts given freely be an expression of our appreciation for all that you do for us. In Jesus' name, amen. Our Father, our closing hymn is Love Divine, All Love Excelling. I believe 384 in the big hymnal.
Thank you.
in peace, and as Pastor said, where our faith is tested when things are down, things are tough. And I'm a believer in that, because the Spirit is there and it's with us, and may it be with you too. Have a great week.